esteemed chairperson, of course, he has delivered his speech and left. Professor Chintamani Mahapatra, esteemed Professor Udayanath Sahu, I am grateful to him for giving me this opportunity to share the pleasure of listening to Professor Kapil Kapoor, and I will listen to you also, and share the pleasure of this seminar, international seminar. And Professor Om Prakash Singh and Dr. Netaji Abhinandan. I feel happy when I utter his name, Netaji Abhinandan. मुझे लगता है कि मैं अभिनंदन करती हूँ नेताजी को. Always Netaji is to be Abhinandan. And I'm happy that I met personally Professor Om Prakash Singh and also listened to Professor Kapil Kapoor. I was thinking while listening to him that I would have written my novel. I wrote the novel 33 years back. Draupadi I wrote 33 years back, and the original title is Yagyasena, not Draupadi. In Hindi they made it Draupadi. So I am very selective when I title the story or novel. But in Hindi isko Draupadi kar diye. However, I was thinking after listening to Professor Kapoor, I would have written that novel. So vivid knowledge, so good analysis. I have so little knowledge about Mahabharata when I listen to him. I want to be a student of Professor Kapoor now also. Really, I was feeling. So I am not a person of literature. My original background is science. Then I read educational psychology and became professor of education, and served 35 years in Odisha government and then Public Service Commission, but I write in Odia. So I have very poor knowledge in Odia and also history and also Puran, etc. I have a novel on Ahalya. While writing Ahalya, I think my study of Ramayana and different characters were more thorough than while I was writing Draupadi. I wrote long back, 30 years back. However, I should come to topic. Being a teacher, I should stick to topic. I think Mahabharata is the perennial inspiration and eternal panacea for all the diseases, social evils happening today. What happened yesterday in Jammu and Kashmir? Mahabharata is the perennial inspiration to avoid those things, and that is the eternal panacea. Let me start from Adi Parva of Mahabharata. In Adi Parva of Mahabharata, it was written, poets have narrated it before, poets are narrating it now, other poets shall narrate this history on earth in the future. It is history, they have written it is history. So what Kapil Kapoor ji was telling, whether it is happened or not happened, we doubt history. They said in Adi Parva, it was written, it is history. The appeal of Mahabharata is never ending, not merely nationally, but also universally. It is a human drama that has been staged before, is being staged now, and will be staged for all time to come. Every bit of Mahabharata is essentially human. It is beyond border and time. A proud claim is made on behalf of Mahabharata about this. In the realm of religion and ethics, dharma, artha, kama, moksha, that is religion and ethics, material progress and prosperity, pleasure of personal and social life, and of spiritual emancipation, whatever is embodied in this epic may be found elsewhere, but what is not found in the epic, it will be impossible to find anywhere else. In Odia it is said, Jaha nahi Bharate, taha nahi Bharate. Whatever is not in Mahabharata, that is not in Bharat. The meaning is that. So, actually Mahabharata, after Mahabharata, what we will written, we will repeat the same thing in our fiction, in our writing, in our poetry. We'll be repeating the same thing in a new way. Mahabharata is not only the source of inspiration for Indian literature, but also source of aspiration, inspiration and consolation for Indian people, men and women, irrespective of age, caste, creed, religion and different social strata. The Mahabharata, fortunately available to us today, consists of 1 lakh stanzas. It is said that Mahabharata is 8 times as big as today. Homer's Iliad and Odyssey combined together was Mahabharata, but we have 1 lakh stanzas today. It is world's biggest and greatest epic, not only for its size, but for its versatility and its concern for totality of life. Mahabharata has become a part of our lives, though not read by all. It is handed over from generation to generation through different tongues in India. It is also retold and recreated, reinterpreted, and not only by Bhasha literature of India, but also in some foreign languages by great scholars and Indologists. Even one fiction writer in England has written a novel on Draupadi, and he wrote that novel after publication of my novel. There are so much similarity in some pages. Some reader wrote a letter to me, how it is possible that your novel, some portion of your novel is in his novel. How can I answer? Because I wrote first. You asked him. He is a British people. I don't know how it is so similar. Of course, when he wrote that novel, my novel was translated into Hindi, not into English. Mahabharata, for its myriad of events, characters and subplots, is the narrative form with apparent complexity which has made it grand and great. Is Mahabharata more complex than life? Of course not. Mahabharata is the true portrayal of great battles of human spirit, man's helplessness in the hands of destiny, and voice from transgression to transcendence. The great human drama was staged on the vast pandal, that is earth, under the canopy of heaven long, long ago. And indeed, it is the longest drama which doesn't end. There is no last scene in the final dialogue in Mahabharata, because, strangely enough, it appears itself in and outside of human psyche, in the society, in the world, every moment. There are time of happiness, depression, sickness, death, grief, and self-despair when everything seems to vanish into our own darkness, like Duryodhan and Dhritarashtra after the Mahabharata war. Even victory becomes a burden, pushing Yudhishthir into remorse and depression. This is the goal of the world. Everything is humanly human, everything is humanly human and earthly real in Mahabharata. But everything is capable of acquiring meanings in the earth, who is changing with changing times and social values, be it Homer's Ulysses and as much as Vyasa's Mahabharata. In Mahabharata, the earth is heavenly and the heaven is earthly, where the knowledgeable and wise, the God and Guru, had to commit the gravest human follies, the envy and deceit, the meanest selfish desire, great greed to wealth and lust for woman, conspiracy for power, and finally resulted in Kurukshetra war, leading to the tragic end to all powerful Kauravas. Prosperous Indraprastha was devastated in spite of Bhishma Pitamaha consigning himself to the most painful bed of arrows and chosen death. It is difficult to think Indian culture in terms of any relation the way it is possible to think of European culture in terms of Christianity. It is true that diverse religio-mythical beliefs and practices do not mix, but some other sometimes of their essence does osmose into each other when they live together for a long time. The life experience of a modern man, indeed, in deep and higher sense, is not very different from the primordial aboriginal dreaming heroes of Australia, the man in the age of Mahabharata. I am mentioning Orissa's Adikavi Sarala Das because Sarala Das chair organizes this. I should mention him with respect. Orissa's Adikavi, you must know that the regional Mahabharata written in different languages of India, Adikavi Sarala Das Odia Mahabharata is the first complete Mahabharata written by one person in regional language. And it is very vast, and so many characters, so many events than original Vyasa's Mahabharata. Odisha's Adikavi Sarala Das, who wrote the great Mahabharata in 1470 AD in Odia, witnessed Duryodhan sinking in a self-created river of blood of his own sons and brothers. And how often Krishna touches Kubuja to transform her, and how often Krishna utters lies, Nareba Gunjare Asastama Hata, to establish Dharma on earth. To establish dharma, you have to sometimes follow Krishna, it is said. It is not necessary to narrate the story in the Aranyaka Parva about the small source of water guarded by Yaksha. Yaksha's first question was, what is highest dharma for the people living in this world? How true and human was the answer of Yudhishthir in response to this question of Yaksha? The answer was Ahimsa is the supreme dharma of the world, and everybody knows how Dharmaraj Yudhishthir has been doubly rewarded for this answer. The answer emphasizes two words, dharma and Ahimsa. Here, dharma is in its highest form of meaning. It is not religion. Here dharma is principle of humanity, and the other word ahimsa is the true dharma of all dharmas for all time to come. So how pertinent the two words dealt and depicted in Mahabharata are for the present political, social and familial scenario of life the world over, when war and violence has become a cult. Vyasadeva has shown us a world war and its devastating consequences. Sarala Das, after thousands of years, again showed us another world war in minute details of more intense and violent nature in his Mahabharata, and its consequences and devastating result. Deviating from Vyasa's Mahabharata, Sarala Das created a scene where Duryodhana lamented just before the Mahabharata war that his ego, greed, lust, selfishness and conspiracy against the Pandavas resulted in Mahabharata war. It could have been avoided. This deviation was made intentionally to explain the cause and effect and ultimately of war in human history. Every moment man's heart cries, every moment man's heart cries out for a lasting and permanent peace. At this situation, Mahabharata is a warning to the warmongers. Painful surgery and bloodshed is not the solution to save planet Earth. The message man has got from Mahabharata is peace, the only panacea to save the world, and therefore the writer in me prayed for peace and wrote in her Odia novel Jagyasena Draupadi, O Lord Krishna, let not the wars ever cloud this earth, and let not the petty differences of human mind be let not be petty differences of human mind be any land from as divided as Indraprastha and Hastinapura. Here I indicated this Indraprastha and Hastinapura for Bharat and Pakistan. For a difference of mind, there should not be any division between two rashtras. The consequence is so bad, which we are seeing. Therefore, my Draupadi did not want to go to heaven in body, but wanted to make a heaven of earth. Not salvation, but rebirth was her last wish. She wanted to burn again and again in this earth, so close and so beautiful and so dear to her earth, her heart, which had been devastated by Kurukshetra war and will be again devastated if war occurs for the petty differences of human ego. Her last words to Lord Krishna who was her priya Sakha. He says, Sakha, no war, peace to the world. This is my last prayer. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. This is the final message we got from Mahabharata. You just consider this non-violence and shanti, whether it is regional, Indian or universal. This is applicable world over, to save the world, to save our future generation, to save the human civilization. Thank you very much.